Good morning. Good morning. A word of welcome to all of you who have come to the William Lazareth Lecture and Convocation here at LTSP, both those who are gathered in the room and those who are streaming us and will watch it later. We're delighted that you could be here. Just a word of background before we move to what you all are gathered here to listen to. William Lazareth taught theology at LTSP for nearly 20 years. As anyone who knew him knows already, he was known as an incisive thinker, an astute churchman, an exceptional scholar and teacher who challenged his students always to think critically and deeply about the traditions they had inherited and the church and world in which they would minister. But while the seminary benefited from his keen and inquisitive intellect, Lazareth's legacy went well beyond the walls of the Mount Airy Seminary. Author of a dozen books and numerous articles, he also oversaw the drafting of the World Council of Churches Statement on Baptism, Eucharist, and Ministry, one of the most read and influential church documents of the 20th century. Intensely involved in the great ecumenical movements of the last century, Lazareth also served the church as a pastor, including pastor of Holy Trinity Lutheran Church in Manhattan, and as bishop of the Metropolitan New York Synod, lending each and really every office he held a gravitas and focus that few can emulate. Franklin Drewsfry, we have a room over there named in his honor, my first colleague in ministry and a lifelong friend of Bill Lazareth, once said to me that he thought so much of Lazareth's later career could be traced back to the unsatisfactory experience he had as a first-year student at Harvard Law School, after which he enrolled in seminary. Had Bill gone to Yale instead of Harvard, Frank said, he would have found an approach to law that satisfied his temperament and probably would have ended up as a Supreme Court justice rather than as a theologian and bishop. Thankfully for us, he went to Harvard. Indeed, we are grateful for this servant of the church and alum of this school, just as we are grateful for the generosity of Hans and Siri Quitmeyer, members of Holy Trinity, where Hans served as church council president under Pastor Lazareth. Their gift makes it possible for us to continue cultivating a life of the mind and spirit that William Lazareth both encouraged and modeled. And Larry, we are so grateful that you have agreed to come and lead us into that venture. I'll turn us now to Professor Storm Swain, who will lead us in a word of prayer.
I invite you to join me in prayer. O give thanks to our God, who is good, whose love endures forever. You sun and moon, you stars of the northern and southern skies, give to our God your thanks and praise. Sunrise and sunset, night and day, give to our God your thanks and praise. All mountains and valleys, grassland and scree, glacier, avalanche, mist and snow, give to our God your thanks and praise. You redwood and pine, maple and birch, mosses and ferns, give to our God your thanks and praise. Dolphins and bluefish, sea lion and crab, coral and anemone, mussel and shrimp, give to our God your thanks and praise. Raccoons and cattle, fireflies and dogs, eagle and sparrow, an owl and hawk, give to our God your thanks and praise. You indigenous and colonial, women and men, all who inhabit the land of the dawn, give to our God your thanks and praise. We pray for the hungry and the overfed. May we have enough. For the mourners and the mockers, may we laugh together. For the victims and the oppressors,
may we share power wisely.
For the peacemakers and the warmongers,
may your truth and stern love lead us to harmony.
For the silenced and the propagandists,
may we speak our own words in truth.
For the unemployed and the overworked,
may our impress on the earth.
For the troubled and the sleek,
may we live together as wounded healers.
For the homeless and the cosseted,
may our homes be simple, warm,
for the vibrant and the dying. May we all die to live. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite Dr. Katie Day, the Charles A. Sheeran Professor of Church and Society, to the podium to introduce Dr. Rasmussen.
It is indeed a delight and an honor to be able to introduce Larry Rasmussen, who is a mentor I've never formally studied with, but mentor nonetheless, a friend and a colleague. Many of you will recognize Dr. Rasmussen from his years at Union Seminary, where he was the Reinhold Niebuhr Professor of Christian Ethics. Prior to that, he was at Wesley Seminary in Washington, D.C., where he taught ethics. And before that, he was at St. Olaf, so he comes with good Norwegian credentials. Larry was also the St. John's visiting professor here in 2006 and is fondly remembered not only for his Bonhoeffer seminar, but also for adding his voice to the seminary choir. And we haven't quite recovered since you left the choir, Larry. He is a well-known in the field of social ethics. Dr. Rasmussen is the past president of the Society of Christian Ethics and the past editor of the annual of the Society. He has co-moderated the unit within the World Council of Churches on justice, peace, and creation. He is recognized for his leadership, serving on the boards of St. Olaf and LSTC, our sister seminary in Chicago, and has been given many awards, including the Sittler Award for Outstanding Leadership in Theological Education and the Bernus Feldman Award for Distinguished Christian Ministries in Higher Education. He was honored in 2004 when he retired at AAR SBL for his work, particularly in ecological issues. Dr. Rasmussen has been prolific in writing as well as speaking and organizing. He has written books on the Bible and Christian ethics, and then a well-known book on Reinhold Niebuhr, another on Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and he was an editor of one of the editions of the Dietrich Bonhoeffer works in English. But he has found his true stride, his true love in environmental ethics. And so he has written, co-written a number of books, and particularly solo written Earth Community, Earth Ethics, that came out in 96. And then the one that is in the back, Earth Honoring Faith, Religious Ethics in a New Key, published by Oxford in 2012. So that is available at a cut rate, thanks to Oxford and to Dr. Rasmussen. And he will be available to sign any books that are purchased. When he and his wife, Nyla, retired, they moved to Santa Fe, New Mexico, and it is debatable whether he was retired or retreaded. He has been very involved while there, doing organizing seminars on issues around environmental justice at Ghost Ranch. And if you've never been there or never been to those seminars, please put that on your bucket list. He's also been involved in leadership with the Interfaith Power and Light organization, and he met last night with the Pennsylvania chapter of that group. He's worked on many issues, including the Living Wage campaign, which was successful there. And just returned from 7 weeks in Scotland with his wife celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary. For those of you who know Larry, back of his accomplishments is one with a warm and generous spirit. His is a brilliant mind, and yet a curious mind, who is happiest in dialogue. He knows that we're smarter together. He deeply values working together in collegiality and conversation in tackling the most challenging of ethical issues and life issues, particularly the survival of our planet. It is my great, oh, did I mention your humility? Yeah. It is my great honor to introduce Dr. Larry Rasmussen.
Good morning. I was at a meeting lately where the person told of introducing Desmond Tutu, and Archbishop Tutu said upon coming to the podium, "You forgot to mention my humility." That's where that comes from. Well, first of all, good to be back. And congratulations to the seminary, 150 years and a new president. You only have 149 years to go here for the next stretch. And it's a personal pleasure to be giving the William Lazareth endowed lecture. Bill Lazareth, I learned from, and he was my bishop when we were members at Trinity Evangelical Lutheran in Manhattan. Now, you will find very shortly that I'm a rather severe critic of capitalism, but it doesn't kick in until those books are sold back there. So. And you can actually get them for what will be the price of the forthcoming paperback. So it's a good deal all the way around. All right, from social justice to creation justice, what would it take, or what does it take? The Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stones. For us, the question is, will the fossil fuel age end because we've left coal, oil, and gas in the ground? Or do we continue burning them? Max Weber feared the latter. He ended his classic book, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, first published in 1904, with the modern capitalist order pictured as an iron cage in which we've trapped ourselves, bound to, quote, the tremendous cosmos of the modern economic order, the lives of all of the individuals who are born into this mechanism are determined with irresistible force, Weber wrote. And then he went on, perhaps this order will so determine them until the last ton of fossilized coal is burned. That was more than 100 years ago. A century and change later, on the very same March day that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, released its fifth assessment report, strengthening yet again the scientific consensus about human-induced warming, ExxonMobil, the most profitable business in the history of money, issued a statement saying that it sees no end to the burning of oil and gas. Now, the difference between Weber in 1904 and the IPCC and ExxonMobil in 2014 is that now this tremendous economic cosmos, thanks to those vast supplies of compact stored energy in the form of fossil fuels, brings us the mounting trauma of a new epoch on the only planet fine-tuned for us as planet home. A placard at the People's Climate March a couple weeks ago, three weeks ago, I guess, in New York City, put it this way: there is no planet B. That's the setting for this theme, from social justice to creation justice, what does it take? But is the subtitle even necessary at all? Isn't creation justice simply an intensification of social justice, not least because those peoples and places most directly impacted by climate change are those that have contributed least to it? Is not the urgency of social justice ratcheted up by climate change in a way that leads, by its own logic, to creation justice? Island peoples displaced by rising seas or typhoons of biblical proportions, or subsistence farmers displaced by changing seasons and new pests and diseases, or coastal communities facing budget-busting protection against rising seas. Surely responses to extreme events such as these must work collaboratively to share the burdens equitably and meet elemental human needs. Moreover, haven't we already begun the transition from social justice to creation justice long before Weber's last ton of fossilized coal has become coal ash and greenhouse gas? The United Church of Christ, the Unitarian Universalists, Union Theological Seminary, and no less than the Rockefeller Brothers Fund are divesting from fossil fuels in the name of climate justice. So aren't we already on the way across the threshold to creation justice from social justice at just the right moment? I thought so, until I realized that what is now happening to planet home not only renders much social justice problematic, it carries the same disconcerting doubts into our best efforts at creation justice. So while it is a time for all of us in religious communities to lead, and while justice-loving people like you are among those most able to do that on the ground, the leading we need in the time we have is something, I think, quite different from simply intensifying the kind of justice we know. Let me signal the difference between 1904 and 2014 that matters most, and then crawl back through a little history that helps position us for new tasks in the midst of new dimensions. Let me also signal my eventual conclusion, namely that if social justice itself is not henceforth also creation justice, it too will fail. The difference that sends pounding waves crashing on all shores is this: a new age, a new earth age, is upon us. The late Holocene had a good run, 11,700 years, until our very recent past. Its distinctive mark, this geological epoch, has been climate stability sufficient to allow the triumph of life over and again. And its importance for us is that the late Holocene has hosted every single human civilization to date, bar none. So say a prayer of thanks. You can add it to Storm's list up there. Say a prayer of thanks to the Holocene. It's been the time of our lives. Now our time, however, is another. Some scientists have already christened it the Anthropocene. God only knows why all geologists speak Greek, but they do. Holocene means the wholly recent epoch. Anthropocene is from anthropos, Greek for human, excuse me, and so named because of the pervasive human influence throughout Earth's systems. This anthropos has modified the flows of most rivers and changed the catchment areas of the world. This anthropos has re-engineered more rock, soils, and landscapes than the last century did with volcanoes, earthquakes, and glaciers. The role of the carbon cycle in the acidification of the oceans, acidifying faster than they have for 8 million years, and the re-regulation of solar radiation is a role that has fallen to this Anthropos because this Anthropos has taken it. This Anthropos is now the main agent in the planet's nitrogen cycle. This Anthropos now sends innocent species to eternal death at a quickening pace. This Anthropos has in fact brought on a new geological epoch whose tattoo is not climate stability but climate volatility. It is not a metaphorical creation that groans in travail, awaiting the redemption of this Anthropos. It is the literal one. A new Earth age. Let me cite the summary from Climate Science as passed along by one of the authors of three of the IPCC reports, Robert Stabenes. Quote, "The world is now on track to more than double current greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere by the end of the century. This would push up average global temperatures by 3 to 8 degrees Celsius and could mean the disappearance of glaciers, drought in the mid to low latitudes, decreased crop productivity, increased sea levels and flooding, vanishing islands and coastal wetlands, greater storm frequency and intensity, the risk of species extinction, and a significant spread of infectious diseases," end quote. Well, the good news, there is a great awakening underway. I personally think the People's Climate March, including very significant presence on the part of self-identified faith communities, is a tipping point for climate reality response. I happened to be in London, not New York, that weekend, and in every station of the underground was a poster. It was of Big Ben. The Houses of Parliament themselves were pictured underwater, except for Big Ben, and the words across the top, which you can't see there, were, "Next time, it won't be biblical." Other words, as you can see, announced the People's Climate March in London for September 21st. 40,000 people showed up. Yet whether or not the bells that toll have been heard as the alarm they are, I'm quite certain of three things that were not self-evident for Max Weber. And all three scramble the reality for social justice. First, humanity is now the single most decisive force of nature itself. Most systems of the natural world are currently embedded as part of human systems or profoundly affected by human systems. That includes the high atmosphere. That includes the ocean depths, the polar regions. It was never thus, but it is now, and for all foreseeable futures. Future generations are going to look back at us in awe and wonder, fear, and anger. Secondly, nature has changed course. The scientists of the International Geosphere Biosphere Program claim that, quote, "evidence from several millennia shows that the magnitude and rates of human-driven changes to the global environment are in many cases unprecedented." And their conclusion, quote, "there is no previous analog for the current operation of the Earth system." There is no previous analog for the current operation of the Earth system. Industrial humanity has brought on a non-analogous moment, a unique geologic epoch, and not just historic epoch. Third, in contrast to the climate stability of the Holocene, the mark of the Anthropocene is climate volatility and uncertainty. Okay, what does this wild, non-analogous time mean for social justice and creation justice. If our swollen powers, to cite Willis Jenkins, are now exercised cumulatively across generational time, aggregately throughout ecological systems, and non-intentionally over evolutionary futures, then the time and space dimensions of both human agency and human responsibility are stretched beyond anything humans have known. If no natural terrain goes untouched and unchanged by both human goodness and human molestation, then everything turns on our actions and choices, with consequences not just for present as well as future generations of humankind, but for all the other relatives on the ark. And incidentally, the ark, too, I think, captured a number of marchers' attention in New York. There was an ark on the streets. Let me bare my soul. I find this swelling of human impact and responsibility a frightening prospect for two reasons. First, while the new reality means the ascendancy of ethics for our era as an utterly practical affair, because everything turns on human choice and actions, our canons and institutions of moral responsibility and justice don't begin to match the down and dirty consequences of actual human power, cumulative human power. The neighbor we are to love as we love ourselves is no longer the neighbor close at hand in time and space only. We will be the cause of unknown Jericho Road victims three generations hence, because we handed them a diminished and dangerous planet. Put it this way, how are we to be good Samaritans to neighbors we'll never meet? What canons and practices of present love and justice have that kind of reach? Second, despite the greater reach of Homo sapiens sapiens, there's little evidence that human nature itself has budged much since Homer, certainly not since Shakespeare, maybe not since Cain. We're short-sighted sinners, and we're good at both short-sightedness and sinning. Yet what truly matters is long-haul, long-term righteousness. Are we capable? Is it in our nature to fashion a justice that matches the far-flung consequences of our real-time powers? Cultures certainly do change, and they can be highly varied, even if human nature doesn't change a whole lot. So maybe we can do this, and there certainly have been and are cultures that are seven-generation cultures. So we can do this. Well, let me say this a little bit differently. We're people of stories and people of song. Every way of life is a narrative lived as a damned opera. So it's important to ask, as we exercise all too real dominion by way of vast interlocking systems of great complexity across extended time and space, are we telling the right story about ourselves and singing the right songs, living it well? Do we know who we are in a new epoch? And have we found the right music for hymning the earth differently? Probably not, if our best justice can barely imagine the new forms of responsibility needed for creatures with earth-altering powers. Indeed, present justice may, in its impotence, leave us all orphans. Now, at this juncture, I feel a little bit like the person bound for Aberdeen who, uncertain she's on the right road, stops a stranger to ask, "Can I get to Aberdeen?" "You can," comes the reply, "but I wouldn't start from here if I were you." Can we get to creation justice for a new earth age? We can, but present social justice may not be the place to start. I again list some changes that bring on the Anthropocene. Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew calls them crimes against creation. But this time I ask you, what mode of social justice readily identifies the following as compelling justice issues? Here's the list: disappearing species, eroding soils, altered gene pools, collapsing fisheries, souring seas, melting glaciers, river delta dead zones, migrating pests and diseases, rising sea levels, biodiversity loss, bleaching coral reefs, surface temperature climbs, more intense storms and flooding, deeper drought, and climate instability. Next question. If climate volatility and the rest of that dismal list are morally awkward for social justice, what would it take to transform social justice so as to become creation justice while at the same time not losing the fire of social justice? What would it take, for example, for a preferential option for the poor to also be a preferential option for renewing planetary creation? The fire of social justice must not be lost because climate change makes social justice both more difficult and more urgent. More difficult because injustice has a farther reach in space and time and probably fewer resources, at least relative to the scale of the problems. And more urgent because, as mentioned, those who contribute least to climate injustice are those who suffer most from it. Indeed, with climate injustice, life as unfair is on steroids. So is it not a time to ask with fierce honesty whether social justice can be transformed for its vocation as creation justice? Now, to get a leg up on the answer, I'm going to turn to why modern Protestant social justice emerged in the first place. It arose in response to what was identified early in the 20th century as, quote, the social question or the modern social problem, end quote. The phrases are those of Ernst Troeltsch, a contemporary of Max Weber's. Troeltsch was responding to the iron cage consequences of the new economic cosmos of industrialized nature. And Troeltsch wrote this in 1911. The social problem is vast and complicated. It includes the problem of the capitalist economic period and of the industrial proletariat created by it, and of the growth of militaristic and bureaucratic giant states, of the enormous increase in population, which affects colonial and world policy, of the mechanical technique, which produces enormous masses of materials and links up and mobilizes the whole world for purposes of trade, but which also treats men and labor like machines, end quote. These were the consequences of the economy that was made famous in Adam Smith's work of 1776, the inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations. Smith had already identified the engine, soon named capitalism, not by Smith, but by French philosophers, and it was already a world-shaping power. Not that many years later, Karl Marx, shocked and awed by this capitalism, wrote the following. This was in 1848. The bourgeoisie, during its rule of scarce 100 years, has created more massive and more colossal productive forces than have all preceding generations together. subjection of nature's forces to man machinery, application of chemistry to industry and agriculture, steam navigation, railways, electric telegraph, clearing of whole continents for cultivation, canalization of rivers, whole populations conjured out of the ground. What earlier century even had a presentiment that such productive forces slumbered in the lap of social labor? 1848 was barely on the cusp of the application of chemistry to industry and agriculture, clearing of whole continents for cultivation, canalization of rivers, whole populations conjured up out of the ground. 160 and more years later, all those factors and more belong to our earlier note that nature's systems are now embedded in human systems and profoundly influenced by them, the weather included. And while Marx was spectacularly wrong in the prophecy that the proletariat would become the gravediggers of the bourgeoisie and that the coming socialist revolution would upend capitalism, he was, like Troeltsch and Walter Rauschenbusch in the Social Gospel, dead on about the atomization of society and the exploitative, alienating nature of industrial orders that nonetheless captivated people with the lure of enormous productivity and mounting material prosperity. Had all three, Rauschenbusch, Troeltsch, and Marx, been present in 2014, they would likely not have been surprised at the staying power of the social question and the fact that it has gone global. The assault on settled, intact community still defines our world. The gap between the rich and the poor and the widens while institutions of family, community, and nation state still struggle to stave off atomization and unleashed economic forces, shifting identities, and unsure sovereignties. This might have saddened or maybe angered these students of early capitalism. It probably would not have startled them. Now, the social gospel and other manifestations of Protestant-inspired justice soon responded across a broad front and on innumerable issues. Social justice work included the right to unionize, a minimum wage, decent and safe working condition, housing for workers that went beyond hovels, the franchise, child labor laws, 8-hour day, legal recourse to discrimination in hiring and firing, protests against obscene wealth for the robber barons but meager rewards for those receiving slave wages, and some beginning provisions then for child care and health care. Does the 21st century report anything else? Yes. And it was largely unnoticed by Rauschenbusch and Troeltsch, a little less so by Marx. The ecological question joined the social question. It, too, is the direct outcome and downside of the organization habits and exacting requirements of modern industrial technological society and its ever-expanding extractive economy. It manifests itself as the unending transformation of nature, a parallel to the unending transformation of society, and both of them in pursuit of mammon. We cited its warning signs earlier: shrinking habitat, disappearing species, eroding soils, altered gene pools, polar region and glacial melting, rising sea levels, stronger storm surges, drought and deluge, etc. Like the social question, too, the ecological question has now gone global. Now, I've crawled back through this history so that we notice what has largely gone missing from our notion of social justice, namely the natural world as worthy of such reverence that it might make moral claims upon us or itself be the recipient of due justice. The People's Climate March may well signal a turning point here too. But historically, Protestant social justice has effectively affirmed the tremendous economic cosmos of the industrial paradigm. Whether industrial socialism or industrial capitalism, the quest of social justice and its glory has been to render the benefits and the burdens of the Industrial Revolution fairer in the lives of those determined by it. But this justice was itself captured by the economic cosmos that has been tone deaf to the deep needs of the natural world upon which it depended, lock, stock, and oil barrel. Life lived on some assumptions such as the following. created the ecological question that now overwhelms us. As I read these assumptions, and they are the assumptions of the industrial paradigm, ask not only whether they hold true for the industrial paradigm, but whether they hold true for our justice theory and justice practices. Nature is virtually limitless storehouse of resources for human use. Humanity has the commission to use and control nature. Nature is malleable and can be reconfigured for human ends. Humanity has the right, perhaps even the calling, to use nature's resources for an improvement in its material standard of living. The most effective means to raise material standards of living is ongoing economic growth. I've skipped here. The quality of life is furthered by an economic system directed to ever-expanding material abundance. The future is open. These are on my sheet, not yours. Systematic material progress for the whole human race is possible, and through the careful use of human powers, humanity can make history turn out right. The one I love is this one. The things we control, create are under our control. The good life is one of productive labor and material well-being. The successful person is one who achieves and is on his or her own. Both social progress and individual interests are best served by achievement-oriented behavior in a competitive and entrepreneurial environment. A work ethic is essential to human satisfaction and social progress. The diligent, hardworking, risk-taking, and educated will attain their goals. There is freedom in material abundance. When people have more, their freedom of choice is expanded, and they can and will be more. Now, all of this, I think, is first cousin to Frederick Morton's nice little book called Crosstown Sabbath. Morton, who's narrating the experience of riding the 42nd Street Crosstown bus in Manhattan, describes the fatigue on the faces of the passengers as, quote, classically Judeo-Christian. We are imitating the God of our civilization. Morton says, the workaholic supernal who assembled the world in factory terms, end quote. Then this lovely line, before the Hebrews, no other people had a Sabbath, he writes. No other people needed one. Differently said, social justice, as it emerged here, while admirably driven by fair play and fair outcome for human communities, is justice shorn of any sophisticated doctrine of creation. Accept creation as the decor for the human and a storehouse of resources to be tapped for Homo sapien benefit. The ecological question has little presence in either the formation or the execution of this justice. This is justice that assumes human well-being is primary, even though our well-being is always derivative of something more basic, namely planetary well-being. This justice also assumes that the basic unit of human survival itself is human society. It is not. It is planetary creation comprehensively, with all of the primal elements, earth, air, fire, water, truly primary. The human good is not even possible without care for the good of the planetary commons. And the working understanding of creation here is unworthy. Even God seems to exist, for all practical purposes, only in relation to one late-arriving species perched on one little twig of the great tree of life. Honey, we shrunk not only the kids, we shrunk the cosmos and its creator and sustainer. Now, please understand, my criticism is not a criticism of what Protestant social justice has included and has accomplished. It has not only taken on the vital issues that we mentioned, it has been spot on in developing the means by which we now do race, gender, and class and cultural analysis, thereby demonstrating in detail the gross injustice of severely maldistributed benefits and burdens. Liberation theologies refine these analytical tools, and like the Hebrew prophets, they made the locus and play of power a centerpiece of theological and social ethical method itself. That focus on power and that laying bare of injustice are precious gifts that now belong to both social and environmental justice. Yet the humanity-nature dualism of most modern Western Protestant justice traditions worked like blinders on a horse. Straight ahead attention rendered off to the side the growing and unsustainable footprint of humanity in every natural domain that mattered. The carbon footprint, the water footprint, the biodiversity footprint, the ecological footprint, referring to land and energy footprints, and the material footprint, meaning the measure of resources used. Now, it looks like this. You won't be able to read all the fine print, you don't need to. This first page of graphs shows the unsustainable appetites that have, especially since 1950, that's where the hockey stick lines really show up. The date on the left is 1750, the conventional date given for the onset of the Industrial Revolution. And then growth in each of these sectors, whether it's McDonald's restaurants or paper consumption or foreign investment or automobiles or telephones or international tourism, highly disparate factors. Then at post-World War II, then you have the screeching escalation that to 2000, and it continues, and those lines continue going up in the decade that follows these graphs, this is the way of graphing on sustainability. And it's all driven by the top two factors on the left. The human population, which went from 1.6 to 6.1 billion in one century, and now we're 7 plus billion, on the top left, and then gross real GNP, think global economic activity. So human population and human economy drive all of the rest of this. Now, one way to read this is not just sustainability, unsustainability, that is, you can't keep going with those trend lines. It's also to read that this is that unprecedented material abundance and well-being for billions of people. So this is a positive answer to one of the three classic ecological or economic issues and problems. Can you produce enough to address human needs. And that one has been solved. You can. At least that's what we did in this screeching escalation following World War II. So this is a measure of human well-being, at least productivity for it, on the one hand. But on the other hand, this is what happened to the planet. So the top three across from left to right are the greenhouse gases, or three of the greenhouse gases. And then you see others on floods, temperature change, coastal zones, the biochemistry of the oceans, global biodiversity, terrestrial ecosystems, ozone, and so on. Exactly the same hockey stick line, the same screeching escalation. But here, it's planetary degradation at the expense of material well-being. So, this is what has brought on the Anthropocene. I'm keenly aware that we love this iron cage of Max Weber. To remember Frederick Jameson's quip, it's actually easier to convince Americans of the end of the world than it is to convince them of the end of capitalism. All right. The conclusion is twofold. First, we have the global reality that Naomi Klein describes in this way. Our economic system and our planetary system are now at war. Or more accurately, she says, our economy is at war with many forms of life on Earth, including human life. What the climate needs to avoid collapse is a contraction in humanity's use of resources. What our economic model needs to avoid collapse is unfettered expansion. Only one of these sets of rules can be changed, and it's not the laws of nature. End quote. If the laws of nature don't permit infinite growth on a finite planet, then for social justice, which has largely assumed such unfettered expansion, to become creation justice, a deep theological, moral, and policy transformation is required. And I'm going to finish with some suggestion in what I hope is just opening up, at least it is for me, a lot of questions about the relationship of social and creation justice. The first two in this starter list of requirements are policy transformations. In keeping with the ancient Christian understanding of oikos, that Greek word for household, which is the root word for our words ecology, economy, and ecumenics, economics and ecology must merge to become economics. That is to say, economics embeds all human economic activity within the ecological limits of nature's economy, upon which the human economy is built. And it pursues a three-part agenda of production, relatively equitable distribution, and ecological regenerativity. Growth as a good is not precluded, provided it is ecologically sustainable and regenerative for the long term, reduces rather than increases the instability that large wealth and income gaps generate, and bolsters rather than undermines the capacity of local and regional communities and cultures to nurture and draw wisely upon their cultural and biological diversity. In all events, the first law of economics must be the preservation of the earth economy. Second, another requirement is attention to the planet's climate energy system. Greenhouse gases work exactly like a blanket. They don't produce the heat, the sun does, but they trap and they hold it in a finely tuned system that has been conducive to the triumph of life. Even a few degrees difference can greatly affect how the oceans, the atmosphere, and the community of life process and regulate this planetary energy. It's like your body. 98.6 degrees is normal, you're fine with that. Raise your temperature just a few degrees to 102, you've got a fever, and you're starting to generate some different bodily processes to combat it. Raise it a couple more degrees, you've probably slipped into a coma. While Earth's climate energy system is far more complex than your body's, it too is subject to vast changes initiated by only a few degrees of median warming. Now, my reason for this gloss on Earth's energy system is first because Anthropocene energy use is markedly changing planetary energy processes. While we are resetting the planet's thermostat, however, almost all of our attention to energy is about energy resources and use. Do we have enough to do what we want to do, namely continue to grow the economy to meet human needs and wants? Are we energy independent is another question. And if not, how do we secure independence? And how will energy be distributed fairly? These discussions all go on without first asking what energy sources and uses are mandated by the planet's energy system. We assume that human energy use is primary. Then we'll deal with the environmental effects. So should drill baby drill mean spill baby spill? We'll clean up the mess, pay the fines, and move on to the next quarter's profits in that most profitable of all businesses. This is exactly backwards, as climate scientists readily explain. The first law of energy is preservation of the planet's climate energy system as conducive to life. Human energy use is derivative of the planet's. This is the energy parallel to our assumption that the first law of the human economy is preservation of nature's economy. Still, getting to economic and energy policy, getting it right, vital though that is not likely sufficient for creation justice. A soul deep feel for planetary creation is mandatory. A gut connection that is both earth honoring and earth healing, as well as God praising and God fearing. The whole community of life is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh and is the unmerited, awesome gift of a gracious God. This gut love for creation, not always apparent in our justice work, entails the following, and I finish with these. First, the conviction that all creation is sacred, not only human life. If Robin Nagel, who's an anthropologist working at the New York City's Department of Sanitation, can say, quote, everything in the universe, ourselves included, is garbage, the garbage of exploded stars, and everything in the universe, ourselves included, is sacred. It's all garbage, and it's all sacred. Then Christians ought also to be able to say, creation is worthy of awe and wonder, respect and reverence. That's the definition of sacred. Creation and the incomparable gift of life, its pure grace, bears a value beyond the value accorded it by the industrial paradigm and global consumerism. the value conferred by this economic cosmos, our present one, is unrelentingly and unqualifiedly utilitarian. It is value as determined by humans in light of its use to humans as masters of the house. This unqualifiedly utilitarian ethic is an ethic in which nature's value is market value, and no more. An ethic with no place whatsoever for the sacred, the mysterious, the numinous. It's a kind of thin, secular value that is wrecking the planet and profiting by that wreckage. So N. Scott Mamaday is right. Quote, the most important thing to do for the planet is reinvent the sacred, end quote. Or to summon Max Weber again, the important task is to counter the disenchantment of nature by our modern marketized and monetized cosmos with a reenchantment that restores to nature what it has been, the bearer of mystery and wonder, the medium of the sacred and the presence of the divine. Alice Walker understands reenchantment. The more I wonder, she says, the more I love. Market value neither wonders nor loves. Now, it's vital to add that sacred creation is utterly seamless. As in the Hebrew Bible and in ecological sciences, the fate of people, the land, and its life is a joined fate, just as its origin is a common origin. Second, creation as sacred, seamless, and asking justice of it for its well-being with ours leads to, second element, worthy God talk. Worthy God talk gathers in all of Earth's voices to sing the hymn of creation or to reflect creation's shine of the holy. God talk that does not encompass all 13.8 billion years of the universe's pilgrimage to date and the immense wheeling of 50 to 100 billion galaxies each swimming with like numbers of stars and who knows how many weird planets. God talk that does not gather in all the species come and gone, as well as those leaving as we speak. And God talk that does not embrace the whole drama of life in all of its misery and grandeur is unworthy. Shorn of the universe, the worship of God is worship of a human species idol. It is God rendered in our own smudged image. In The Mass on the World, paleontologist and priest Teilhard de Chardin finds himself praying, shatter, my God, through the daring of your revelation, the childishly timid outlook that can conceive of nothing greater or more vital in the world than the pitiable perfection of our human organism, end quote. Worthy God talk, then, is about the mystery of matter and its drama, all of it, past, present, and future. It's an invitation to sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation, Lutheran liturgy, so as to give voice, however partially and inadequately, to the carnal presence of the uncontained God. The uncontained God is the God of creation justice. The last critical element of creation justice is an upgraded understanding of ourselves, an improved anthropology, if you will. Our present segregated sense of ourselves as a species is a miserably shrunken grasp of who we are in the cosmic scheme of things. From both a scientific and a religious point of view, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, in the phrase of the psalmist, Psalm 139. We're the handsome fruit of two wombs, our mother's and Mother Earth's. So the singer sings of God, for it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Excuse me. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. To be fearfully and wonderfully made. Across the stop and start eons of evolutionary life. To belong to life's drama and grandeur and have a perch of our own on the great tree of life is our glory. To breathe the same air Jesus breathed and stand before the same waters Moses did. To share DNA with most of life and be comprised of atoms about 14 billion years old, that's enough. I just try to act my age, quips Joanna Macy. My atoms are 14 billion years old. When justice is creation justice, it draws on such grandeur and such transcendence as this. Okay, these three spiritual moral elements then added two fundamental changes in economic and energy policy, I think are on the way to transforming social justice to creation justice. Creation deemed sacred and seamless, God talk worthy of the uncontained God, and a fearfully and wonderfully made self and human identity. With such religious substance, the tremendous economic cosmos of that last ton of fossilized coal, Weber, will have more than met its match, namely the wonder of the real cosmos and its economy. Has it been better prayed than in the Yom Kippur services that only last Saturday rose to heaven across the world? I sing in the Beit Tikva choir. Every year when I come to choir practice, my fellow bass says, "Now tell me again, where are you when you're not Jewish?" So I have to tell him, because I'm only there for the High Holy Day, the days of awe. But in these beautiful concluding Yom Kippur services, three almost random quotes. This is the day of awe. What are we as we stand in your presence, O God? A leaf in the storm, a fleeting moment in the flow of time, a whisper lost among the stars. Or, we, dust and ashes, are endowed with divinity. Compounded of clay, we live in dimensions clay cannot enter, regions where the air vibrates with your presence. And alas for those who cannot sing, but die with all their music in them. Let us treasure the time we have and resolve to use it well, counting each moment precious, a chance to apprehend some truth, to experience some beauty, to conquer some evil, to relieve some suffering, to love and be loved, to achieve something of lasting worth. Help us, Eternal One, to fulfill the promise that is in each of us, and so conduct ourselves that generations hence it will be true of to say of us, the world is better because for a brief space they lived in it. And I finish with two images here. Each of these images portrays what I think creation justice at its best would look like now in this new epoch, the epoch of the human, the Anthropocene. This Tree of Life by Kristen Gelly, a Lutheran artist. Is a triptych that she fashioned at Holden Village. It's Revelation 22. So it's the waters that flow from the throne of God through the streets of the city, and on each side of the waters that flow are the tree of life with their fruits for all season. But you see, what Kristen has done is to show the outsized place of the human now in the tree of life. We're not a little twig, we're the trunk. And it is kind of scaringly realistic about that reality. And then the Vietnamese artist Na, and I only have one footprint here, but the larger one has a human being walking. And the human footprint is coterminous with the footprint of the rest of life, so to speak. So it's a mutually enhancing relationship of the human and the rest of the community of life. Thank you very much.